primary division, which is in the front of this building. Let's now give time to our first elder for this interview.
Good morning. How y'all doing? Hope y'all had a nice week. And I hope you're studying your lesson, because this study of Psalms is really good. I told myself that I'm going to read through the book of Psalms before this year's out, and I will. Because I've studied a whole lot of stuff, but I've never studied the book of Psalms. I've read, you know, verses and studied chapters, but I just never read through and, you know, asked God to give me the full understanding of that. So that's one of my goals this week, this year coming up. But I would like to welcome those online too, and we hope you study your lesson too. And so let's see what the psalmist have to say to us today. But first, let's open up with a word of prayer. Father in heaven, I'd like to thank you again for bringing us here safely, Lord. We thank you for bringing us to another week. And we ask now, Lord, as we go into the lesson, that you open up our eyes and our minds and our hearts and teach us, Lord. Just teach us so that we may apply it to our lives. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right, today we're talking, the name of the lesson is, I Will Arise. I Will Arise. And the memory text is, for the oppression of the poor, for the sighting of the needy, now I will arise. Ramel, turn this down a little bit, it's feeding back a little bit. Now I will arise, says the Lord. I will set him in the safety for which he yearns. And that's found in Psalms 12:5. I just want to read the introduction right quick. It says, our age is not the only age in which evil, injustice, and oppression rage. The psalmist lived in such a time as well. And so whatever else they are, the Psalms are also God's protest against violence and oppression in the world, in our world and that of the psalmist as well. Yes, the Lord is long-suffering and holds his wrath in his great forbearance, not wanting anyone to perish, but to repent and change their ways. And though God's proper time for his intervention does not always coincide with the human expectations, the day of God's judgment is coming. We just need to trust him and in his promises until that day comes. Then toward the bottom it says, the twofold aspect of divine judgment includes deliverance of the oppressed and destruction of the wicked. This is what we have been promised. This is what will indeed one day come, but in God's time, not ours, a point that the psalmist emphasized. And that's what we're going to emphasize in today's lesson. You know, Zephaniah 3:8 says, therefore wait for me, says the Lord, until the day I arise up from plunder. My determination is to gather the nations to my assembly of kingdoms, to pour out them my indignation, all my fierce anger. All the earth shall be devoured with the fire of my jealousy. So there are numerous texts that I saw this week where it's to be said, wait on the Lord. Wait on me. Don't take things into your own hands. And we'll get into that. So we are to trust God and wait on him, no matter what. All right? So I just wanted to read that, and that's just an introduction to what we're going to be getting into today. The Majestic Warrior. And it said, read Psalms 18:3-18, Psalms 76:3-9-12, and Psalms 144:5-7. How is the Lord portrayed in these texts? What do these images convey about God's readiness to deliver his people? And before the text, I just want to read what this says first. These hymn praises, which we're going to read in a minute, we're not going to read all of it for time's sake. These hymns praise the Lord for his awesome power over the evil forces that threaten his people. They portray God in his majesty as warrior and judge. The image of God as a warrior is frequent in the Psalms and highlights the severity and urgency of God's response to his people's cries and suffering. So we ought to look to God as our captain, as our leader, as the ultimate warrior. Okay, a lot of times, you know, there's different sides. A lot of times look at the soft side of Christ, which we should, because it helps us. You know, but sometimes God has to show the other side to us personally, corporately, you know, in every aspect of life. But we ought to look to God as our ultimate salvation in anything. All right? Now we can go see what it says, because I like this one. I picked this one out. This is one in Psalm 76, 3, 6 to 10. There he broke the arrows of the bow, the shield and sword of battle. At your rebuke, O God of Jacob, both the chariots and horse were cast into the deep sleep. You yourself are to be feared, and who may stand in your presence when you are angry? You caused judgment to be heard from the heaven. The earth feared and was still. When God arose to judgment to deliver all the oppressed of the earth, surely the wrath of man shall praise you. With the remainder of wrath, you shall gird yourself. He shall cut off the spirit of the princes. He is awesome to the kings of the earth. I mean, to me, that was just beautiful. I mean, that just, the psalmist just describes God as, like I said, the ultimate warrior. Every time I think about it, I think about the ultimate warrior, okay? But you notice at the end, it says, he shall cut off the spirit of the princes. He is awesome to the kings of the earth. And when it's talking about that, who is it talking about? Here, it's not talking about the church. It's talking about world leaders. And we're going to get into that. Okay? It's talking about people in the world who comes against God's people. All right? And then we're going to talk about the church too. But right here, it's talking about that. So who are the kings of the earth? All right? Like I said, those are the leaders. And what does the Bible say about the leaders? How they're going to treat people, oppress the poor, and be oppressive in the last day. You go to James 5:1, show them what they do. Come now, you rich, weep and howl for your miseries that are come upon you. Your riches are corrupted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Ramel, turn it down just a little bit more. Just a little bit more, it's still ringing. Your riches are corrupted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver are corroded, and their corrosions will be a witness against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You have heaped up treasures in the last days. Indeed, the wages of the laborers who mowed your field, which you kept back by fraud, cry out, and the cries of the reapers have reached the ears of the Lord of the Sabbath. So both for the Sabbath. You have lived in the earth in pleasure and luxury. You have fattened your hearts as in a day of slaughter. You have condemned, you have murdered the just. He does not resist you. So God is, these are strong words to those who oppress the poor. Those who cheat you out of wages, who use and abuse us. And a lot of us been through that. You know, I have. I know in my lifetime I have, you know. And all because, you know, I remember when I was young. I don't know if you remember Lee Iacocca. He used to be, I think, the president of Chrysler, I think. And one year, this was like in the 80s or something like that, there was a big crisis, and he was making then, I think his salary was like $30 million a year. And there was a small crisis. So what I'm saying is, instead of, and I was, you know, young hair. And you know, and the crisis dissipated after about a year. But if you're making 25 million, what he did was he laid off 2,000 people. All right? And it may not hit a lot of people like it hit me, but I was thinking that. I was like, and I said, well, why can't he just take 2-3 million off of his salary to keep those people on until the crisis is over? Does that sound too far-fetched to be thinking like that? Does it? Okay. That was just a small example, but this happens and is happening everywhere. All right? People are making millions and billions, you know, and there's nothing wrong with being rich. Let me just say that there's nothing wrong with being rich, but it's what you do with your money where you're going to have to answer to God. Okay? Are you helping the poor? Are you helping people? You know, Sam Walton was one of these guys who helped people. He really cared for people. If you look and see how he set up his corporation. Then the kids took over and then things started getting more corporate. But this is what this is talking about. God is not going to forget this. As we, you know, we think in our minds and sometimes we're home and we're looking and we're angry and upset. This is saying that God will not forget. All right? It says here, the sheer determination and magnitude of God's action should disperse any doubt about God's great care and compassion for the sufferers or about his ability to defeat evil. We just need to wait for him to do it. In other words, he's telling us, you know, if you read the fruits of the Spirit, two of the fruits is patience and long suffering, right? You know, you read the end of the three angels' message, it said, here is the patience of the saints, all right? We have to exercise patience and let God execute judgment. Do we understand that? All right? We really have to. You know, even among us as brothers and sisters, we can't, somebody get us mad and then next week, we just have to wait till next week. I'm going to get them back next week. That's wrong. Even if they did you wrong, God said, wait on me. Just wait on me, but it's hard to do. Don't get me wrong. I know it's hard to do. It's really hard. You know, I failed a lot of times too. But that's why we have to keep reading this and studying it and let the Holy Spirit come overtake our minds. Because we can't do this if we don't have the mind of Christ. That's one of the most underrated texts in the Bible is we need to have the mind of Christ because we cannot do this if we don't have the mind of Christ. Long suffering. Sometimes you got to suffer long, right? One time I remember in my life, I suffered long. But he says, wait, because God knows, first of all, what's best for us. Sometimes he keep us in the oven longer than we want to be to help ourselves. So all the time, we just can't always look at it's the bosses, it's the corporation, it's the government. Sometimes it's you. And me, that God is trying to refine. You understand that? You know, but some people just always want to point the finger at somebody, except for ourselves. All right? Sometimes, you know, it has nothing to do with a corporation or a politician, all this stuff. It just has to do with God trying to save us. So sometimes, I was told a long time ago, God keeps you on your knees a little bit longer. Okay? Because if he lets you up too fast, you're going to go. You're going to forget. So that's how he works. So sometimes he endures long suffering. It said down here, oh, wait a minute. I missed some slides. I'm busy talking. I missed some slides. Let's go back and see what I have. Sometimes I have so much stuff in here that I just forget. I'm just writing down notes, and I got to go back. Oh, okay. This is a good one. Therefore, be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer works for the precious fruit of the earth, waiting patiently for it until it receives the early rain and latter rain. You also be patient. Establish your heart, for the coming of the Lord is not at hand. So it's saying, in general, be patient until the Lord comes because he's the one that's going to execute judgment. Okay? You know, somebody may treat us wrong, And we may not see that person, nothing happened to that person to the day we die. We'll wait for something to happen to them, and sometimes it doesn't work like that. You'll die before anything happened, but God said one day it's going to come. All right? We have to remember that. Although David states that the Lord trained his hand for war, nowhere in the psalm does he rely on his battle skills. Instead, the Lord fights for David and delivers him. And it says at the bottom, praise and prayer to the Lord are David's source of strength, which are more powerful than any weapon of war. God alone is to be trusted and worshiped. So the question is, what do we rely on? See, it just gives us the answer, prayer. And guess what? You don't pray for death to come upon your enemy. You don't, you know, Lord, you need to really kill this person. You know, you don't pray for bad things on people. You know, you pray for God to deliver you, and you pray for that person to find Christ. Right? That's how it's supposed to be, right? But, you know, sometimes we get mad and upset. Somebody told me when you get mad, we suffer from temporary insanity. You ever heard that before? When we get mad, we lose it. And then, you know, that's why a lot of people's in prison, because they lost it for 5 seconds. You know, I remember my father was in the prison ministry, and he said, how many guys he's going in? He said, Brother Munjin, everything was fine. And then next thing you know, I got blood on my hands. Because they lost it and snapped, you know, for 5 seconds. All right? So we ought to pray all the time. You know, not just for now, but for the future. Say, Lord, if this thing comes up, you need to hold me. It says the love of Christ constrains us, right? It really does. It constrains us from doing things that we want to do. All right? Time is flying. All right. So he is the majestic warrior. So now we're going to really get into some stuff right here. Justice for the oppressed. And anybody, who has the mic? Okay, Brother Bunga has the mic if anybody. Brother Deer has the mic if anybody has anything. Read Psalms. And there's a lot of reading of Psalms. Psalms have so much. 9, 18, 12, 5, 14, 17, and 113, 7. What is the message here to us, even today? And we're going to read it right quick. I have three of them on one. So I have three texts on one. It says, for the oppression of the poor, for the sighting of the needy, now I will arise, says the Lord. I will set him in the safety for which he yearns. But I am poor and needy, yet the Lord thinks upon me. You are my help and my deliverer. Do not delay, O my God. And then 113:7, he raises the poor out of the dust, and he lifts the needy out of the ash heap, that he may seat him with princes. So what is this saying? That God will rise, he will deliver, rescue, and save in his own time. We understand that. In his own time, not in ours. But we are to continue to pray and trust that God knows what he's doing. That we have to get that in our mind. No matter how long we're in, remember that Sabbath school lesson I'll remember it in a minute. I can't think of it right now. It was the name of one of our lessons a couple of quarters ago. It means in the oven, in the furnace. Okay? He said, I will arise. I will deliver. Okay? Now, a lot of times when he's talking about arise and deliver, it might not happen in our lifetime. Do you understand that? We wait until, okay, any day now. Okay, it's ultimately talking about when he comes. When he comes, he will deliver us from sin. We're delivered from oppression because we're going home with him. That's the ultimate goal. All right? We can't get too caught up on being delivered from everything on this earth because, like I said, God knows what he's doing. He knows what he needs. He knows where he needs to keep it. It's something like money. God knows who to give money, and he knows who not to give money. And every time we pray, we end it with, and Lord, save me in your kingdom, right? All right. So God said, okay, I'm going to try to save in your kingdom. I know that if I give you money, you're going to be lost. So he keeps it from us. Some people, he can give a lot of money, and they're great stewards, and they know how to use it. You understand? But most Christians, I'm not going to say leave the church, but I think your relationship would be lessened with God if God gave everybody $10 million tomorrow. What do you think? God gave you $10 million. Would you be praying next week as hard as you would last week? And that's what we have to watch out for. We don't know our hearts. God even said we don't know our own hearts. You know, we don't know. You know, God said to study about the Sabbath, keep the Sabbath, you know, enjoy the Sabbath, right? But we don't know when the Sabbath time, when the Sabbath crisis come, if we're not doing this now, we think we're going to keep it then, we're not. That's why we need to do it now. Preparing our heart and mind, getting that love for the Sabbath. And sometimes we get that love for money and we'll just go. So that's that. Well, listen to what it says. God exhibits special care and concern for justice regarding the various vulnerable groups of people, including the poor, needy, oppressed, fathers, widows, and strangers. Now, and there's two kinds of needs. The first is the expression poor and needy is not limited to material poverty, but also signifies vulnerability and helplessness. The expression appeals to God's compassion, and it conveys the idea that the sufferer is alone and has no other help but God. See, a lot of times God leaves people in suffering because he wants you to turn to him. Okay? He keeps you there to turn to him. Not to turn to yourself, not to turn to your family. You know, of course they can help. But ultimately he wants you to ask him for help. So he's there for the physically oppressed, okay? But it says the depiction, poor and needy, also pertains to one's sincerity, truthfulness, and love for God in confessing one's total dependence on God and renouncing any trace of self-reliance and self-assertion. There are spiritual needs. Just like this, people are physically needy, a lot of people are spiritually needy. How does that happen? Well, it comes from lack of reading, sometimes lack of knowledge. Sometimes it's the leaders of the church. You know, if there are people in the world that oppress us, you know there's people in the church that oppress you too, that'll keep you down, that won't tell you the truth, that preach and teach fables. It happens all the time. So our spiritual need, being needy, is important because we need to take care of this first, all right? Our spiritual neediness needs to be first in our mind, and then the rest will fall in place. We understand that, okay? Too many times we look toward the physical first and waiting for something to happen. Nothing happens because we're not looking to the spiritual. All right? We have to look to God. And then once you start with God, everything will fall into place. Not necessarily like the way we want to see it and want it to happen, but you'll get understanding of what God is doing. But if you don't look for God first, you have no idea what's going on. You don't know why you're still in the oven, you know. So we got to understand that. Listen to what this says. The Psalms inspired faithful people to raise their voices against every oppression. The Psalms also underline the fertility of grounding one's confidence on perishable human means as the ultimate source of wisdom and security. God's people must resist the temptation to put ultimate faith for salvation in human leaders and institutions, especially when they differ from God's ways. Do we understand that? Do we understand that? Let me show you how Jesus handled it when he was here and how he dealt with governments. The government under which Jesus lived was corrupt and oppressive. Does that sound familiar? And every hand On every hand were crying abuses, extortion, intolerance, and grinding cruelty. Yet the Savior attempted no civil reforms. He attacked no national abuses, nor condemned the national enemies. He did not interfere with the authorities or administration of those in power. He who was our example, and I think they put that in on purpose, our example, kept aloof from earthly government, not because he was indifferent to the woes of men, but because the remedy did not lie in merely human external measures. To be efficient, the cure must reach men individually and must regenerate the heart. Do we understand that? We understand this. This is a powerful statement. You know, this is talking to us and should be talking to us. All right? God said, don't look to these institutions, all right, and politics and governments to save you. Okay, because a lot of them are not on God's agenda. Do you understand that? God is not talking to them. Now, there's some people in corporate and out there now. Of course, God has people everywhere, all right? But he says, you see what's happening out there. You see what's going on. But yet, we still put in all our mind and our body into who we're going to vote for or who we're going to work for. And thinking that they're going to change something when the Bible plainly says that things will get worse until Jesus Christ comes. Right? So we're looking for a reprieve. We're looking for 20 years of David and Solomon years. I think those days is over. And we can see it happening every day. There's more things happening and there's no answers. Just next time you watch the news, cut off the sound and just look at the faces and see the perplexity on their faces. The arguing back and forth. Nobody knows what to do. And God said, all you have to do is turn to me and I'll show you the way. I'll show you how to get out of it. But they're not going to do it because man's wisdom to us is more important than God's wisdom. And that's what it comes down to. It says, Jesus Christ fulfills the Psalms' promise as a divine judge. He who will judge every mistreatment of the deprived as well as neglect of duty towards him. Bible says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments. This is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. So he's not going to miss a beat. Every thought, every word, every time we was oppressed, it's going to come back. It's going to come back on that individual or that company or whatever happened. And we have to remember that. So now, this is important because it brings us into Tuesday lesson. How long will you judge unjustly? The Lord has endowed Israel leaders with authority to maintain justice in Israel. And that was in Psalm 72, which we're going to read in a minute. Israel's king was to exercise their authority in accordance with God's will. The leader's central concern should be ensuring peace and justice in the land and caring for the socially disadvantaged. Okay, it's letting us know what a leader is supposed to do. Only then shall the land and the entire people prosper. The king's throne is strengthened by faithfulness to God and not to human power. So we got to understand there are divine rules to leading. There are divine rules to being a leader, not only in the church, but in the world. Do we understand that? Do we understand that? And I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you. Psalm 72 says this. Give the king thy judgments, O God, and thy righteousness unto the king's son. He shall judge thy people with righteousness, and thy poor with judgment. He shall judge the poor of the people. He shall save the children of the needy and shall break into pieces the oppressor. He shall come down like rain upon the mown grass, as showers that water the earth. In his days shall the righteous flourish, and the abundant peace so long as the moon endureth. All right? God will judge those who are in charge. The Bible says, from whom much is given, much is what? Required. Leaders in the church and out of the church. So how do we know what's a leader? Okay, there's one verse in the Bible that I always go back to, that this should be everybody's in here motto or aim or whatever have you. And it says, 2 Samuel 23, the Spirit of the Lord spake by me, and his word was in my tongue. The God of Israel said, the Rock of Israel spake to me, he that ruleth over men must be just, ruling in the fear of God. Do we understand that? Is that just talking about the church? Is that just talking about the church? Is it talking about the world too? Okay. So that's saying somebody who's ruling, first of all, need to have the fear of God. That's been established. All right? If they don't have the fear of God, what should we do? Should we still make them elder? Should we still make them pastor? Huh? Should they be senator, congressman, president? Huh? Y'all getting quiet, bro. Okay. And this is something to think about as we go through life and make decisions. Because we overlook this. We always overlook this. And God is telling us right here how your character. I'm not saying be perfect. I'm not saying be Seventh-day Adventist, okay? But your life should be on the path of being a follower of Christ. You have spiritual, moral thoughts on how to lead, okay? In Psalms 82, God declares his judgments upon Israel's corrupt judges. God questions the sons of men whether they judge justly, and their punishment is announced because they have been found unrighteous. The leaders tarding in darkness without knowledge because they have abandoned God's law, the light. All right? Now get this. The scripture unswervingly upholds the view that the Lord is only, hold on, let me read it again. The scripture unswervingly upholds the view that the Lord is the only God. God shares his governance of the world with appointed human leaders and his representatives. And it said, read Romans 13, which you should read that chapter. How often, however, have these human representatives, both in history and even now, perverted the responsibilities that have been given? Right? It says this. Okay, I'm good. Okay, then it also says, Psalms 82 mockingly exposes the apostasy of some leaders who believe themselves to be gods above other people, Okay, this is talking about leaders who oppress people. That's what we're talking about. All right? And it's happened all too often in the church and out of the church. There's people in the church that's starving. You see a lot of these mega churches especially, and pastors are bringing in millions, and people in their audience starving, don't have any food. And you keeping all the tithe and offering, and you're living in your $2, $3 million house, and you have boats and cars and all that, and your congregation, your flock is starving. Same thing happening in the world. I know there are rules in the world. You just can't come in and out this country. You can't do that. There's laws. Everybody got to abide by laws, all right? But when we get to the point to where we've taken humans and using them as pawns, you know, you got people coming in this country, hey, they wrong, send them back, free, all right? But you're sending them to states and leaving them on the doorsteps. And I'm looking at their faces, and I'm like, families, oppression. This is what this is talking about. What leaders are doing. The same thing they're doing there, they do when a husband and a wife going through a divorce, and they use the kids as a pawn. You ever heard of that? You ever heard of that? Try to pull them this way and put stuff in their head and try to use them as a pawn and pull them that way. And don't care about the child. They just worry about themselves and their agenda. Same thing happening in the world. Oppression. God will judge the entire world. And it says God's people too. So it's talking about both. God will judge the entire world. God's people too shall give an account to God. Both the leaders and the people should emulate the example of the divine judge and place their ultimate hope in him, which is God. All right? Because he's showing us right here that it ain't going to work with nobody else. So God is asking us, when are we going to turn to him instead of turning to everything else? He said, if you turn to me, I'll give you everything. I'll send you to the right corporation to work with where they don't oppress you. You know, I'll send your kids to the right school that'll teach them well. But we, for the most part, that really don't care. And that's the bottom line. That's what God says. Things are going to get worse. People don't care about you. People only care about themselves and the almighty dollar. Okay? Yeah. But it says here, in closing, read Psalms. It's called Pour Out Your Indignation. Read Psalms 58, 6 and 8, Psalms 69, 22 and 28, and Psalms 83, 9 through 17, also Psalms 94, 1 to 2. And I hope you read these because they're very important, but I just can't put everything, it said everything up there. What sentiments do these Psalms convey? Who is the agent of judgment in these Psalms? And it says underneath, some Psalms beseech God to take vengeance on individuals and nations who intend to harm them or who have already harmed them, the psalmist or their people. These psalms can sound perplexing because their harsh language and apparent discord with the biblical principles of love for enemies. And it's the same with us. A lot of people, you know, we always talk about the love of Christ and how we should love and you know, love of God. And the psalms do too, but then the psalms come and get hard and say, listen, judgment is coming. Okay? You know, I think it's Psalm 71 that calls out the oppressors, that whole chapter, I believe it's Psalm 71. I should have had that up there. You know? And it's not being mean and evil. You know, do you know there's some churches that don't want you to preach end time because they think you say you're scaring the people? In the Seventh-day Adventist Church, they don't want you to preach end time stuff because it scares the people. They don't think about warning. God is an almighty, loving God who loves everybody and doesn't wish anybody perish. But then God says, listen, that only going to go so far. Get your lives right. Get my life right because judgment is coming. All right? Now I'm going to end on these three. So what is this all saying? Everything we're saying, what is this saying? All right. First one. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Not just us, everybody. And in the context of the lesson, we're talking about oppressors. You will be judged by what you have done to the poor, to the needy, that your day is coming. Number two, the Lord is slow to anger and great in power and will not at all acquit the wicked. We understand that text. There's no way. You will be judged, and if you're found guilty, you know what the sentence is? Eternal death. All right? And this is something that we at who are oppressed put our hat on. Trust God. God is saying this. Trust him. And number three, dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, for it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. Vengeance don't belong to me, or vengeance don't belong to you. Whether it's on a personal level or at work or wherever have you. We are not to harbor hate for somebody in our hearts. Even though we know that they're doing wrong to us. And it's hard, okay, I'm just going to tell you, it's hard. But the closer we get to Christ, it's supposed to get easier, right? If somebody made you mad last year every time they talk, and then they make you mad this year every time they talk, there's something wrong with your Christian journey. You're not getting closer. You're not letting things go, all right? And as we go, you measure yourself. Am I the same person I was 5 years ago? Do everything still upset me? We had a talk in prayer meeting the other day. We were talking about how people get on our nerves. I'm like, listen, if you're 40, 50, or 60 years old, why are we letting people, and then we're Adventists, why are we still letting people get under our skin so much? I don't understand that. We read the Bible, we come to church, we say we this and that, but at the drop of the dime, we never heard of vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. It's like, I'm going to take vengeance, or I'm going to avenge. We should be growing in Christ, and the more we grow in Christ, leave all of the vengeance to God, right? We're supposed to. We really are supposed to. And a lot of times we get in trouble because we want to take things into our own hands. And it really gets us in trouble. Something comes out of our mouth that shouldn't come out of our mouth. And it hurts people. You know, we don't realize how much words can hurt people. All right? So leave it to God. God will avenge. Don't rush him. He knows how this works. We don't. And the last slide I got before I go, another reason we have to wait, but listen to what God is doing. Men of all characters, righteous and unrighteous, will stand in their several positions in God's plan. With the characters they have formed, they will act their part in the fulfillment of history. In a crisis, just at the right moment, they will stand in the places they have prepared themselves to fill. Believers and unbelievers will fall into line as witnesses to confirm truth that they themselves do not comprehend. We don't understand. All will cooperate in accomplishing the purposes of God. Do we understand that? Prophecy has to be fulfilled. The reason why things aren't happening at our pace, because God knows what pace is supposed to happen. There are men that's coming up and women, right, who are preparing themselves to bring us dead smack into the end time. Well, not the end time, into the Sabbath crisis. Sunday laws. All right? So the clock is moving, right? We just don't want to rush God because we're not ready. All right? So while we have the time now, we have to get ready. Leave all the garbage to for Christ to take care of. Don't let people get under your skin and you want to have revenge and all this stuff like that. God will take care of them and he'll take care of you. We understand that. All right? But this is saying that men are coming who's going to move the needle. And maybe women, it's going to move the needle. And it's going to be, and Sister White said that the last movements will be rapid ones. All right? And if we look in the world, we'll see the same thing happening. Bible says watch. Jesus said watch. 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 And we'll know the time. All right? So that's all my time. I can't go on right now. I appreciate you being here. And really, brothers and sisters, we really have to learn how to let God handle all our business. Let him take over our lives and try to get the mind of Christ. Let's bow our heads to close out. Father in heaven, we'd like to thank you again for bringing us here again, Lord. We thank you for your mercies and your watch care. And we thank you for being our ultimate warrior, Father. And we ask for that spirit, Lord, that tender, kind spirit, Father, that you gave us, for us to accept it. And Lord, when things come our way that's against us, when we're oppressed and treated wrong, help us to turn to you, Father. And then pray for those people who oppress us. Because I know you want them to be saved, and we should have the same mind as you, and we should want them to be saved as well. Help us not to harbor a mind of hate and envy and vengeance. So be with us, Lord, as we go through this life. Save us all in your kingdom when you come, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Head Elder Nathan Munjin, for the nice lesson review. At this time, we'll let our deacons receive our Sabbath school offering and also for the mission spotlight offering. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that you have blessed us physically, spiritually, and you have given us the precious gift in Jesus Christ our Lord. Father God, as we will receive the offering, I pray that you will bless this abundantly, that it will serve its purpose, and it will help those in need in other places. Father in heaven, we are so grateful that you still love us, and you have given us the assurance that you will help those who are in need, those who are orphans, and there will be a time of judgment which you will arise, oh God. We are so grateful for that promise, and from this time on, we'll cling to that promise through faith. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Today's mission spotlight comes from India about a person named Terence. Their title is Costly Cup of Tea. Terence stayed up all night to finish a major assignment for a nursing class at Lowry Adventist University in India. He was off campus studying at a friend's house. He was addicted to tea, and he sipped the hot drink all night to stay awake. Around 4:30 a.m., Terence went to the kitchen for another cup of tea, but there was no tea left. He wondered what to do. He was struggling to stay awake, and he just had to finish the assignment, then remembered that a vendor sold hot tea from a stand just down the road. He could zip over to the tea vendor on his friend's motorcycle and then zip right back to finish his assignment. Moments later, Terence was roaring down a major street at 55 miles per hour, 85 kilometers an hour. He was traveling nearly double the speed limit of 30 miles per hour for motorcycles in the city of Bengaluru. He also was not wearing a helmet. Suddenly, a car pulled up beside him. It was traveling at the same speed, and it was filled with young people who were drinking. The young people tried to bring their car closer to Terence and his motorcycle. Terence tried to get away. The young people laughed and tried to steer closer. Terence was worried, and he honked his horn. The young people threw his beer cans. Terence started getting upset, and he shouted at them. The young people heard back insults. Now Terence completely forgot about the road. He was angry. His speed inched up to 65 miles per hour. He didn't see what's coming up in front of him. It was a speed bump. He hit the speed bump and everything went back. One moment, Terence was arguing, and the next, it was like someone had turned off the light. The next thing Terence knew, he woke up in bed. He looked at the clock. It said 8:45 a.m. It was time to go to class to turn in his nursing assignment. Terence tried to get up, but his body did not respond. He tried to call his friends for help, but then he realized that he wasn't in his dormitory room. He looked around, trying to get his bearings. He didn't recognize the place. He saw a calendar. He remembered that he had been working on a nursing assignment in July, but the calendar said it was August. On the wall was a picture of his parents and brother, but he only recognized his brother. He was at home, but he didn't know it. Suddenly, his mother entered the room, seeing Terence was awake. She cried and hugged him. "I'm so glad that you are awake," she said. Terence could only reply, "Who are you?" His words broke his mother's heart. A week passed before Terence recognized his parents. They and other people helped him piece together what had happened. The night of the incident, the pastor at Lowry Adventist University received a call from the police saying, "Take the body." The pastor's number had been under the seat of the borrowed motorcycle as an emergency contact number. Terence had been so badly injured that it took time for the people to realize that the body was his and not that of his friends whose motorcycle he had borrowed. No one knows what happened to the drunk people in the car. Terence drifted in and out of a delirious consciousness for days, and he was transferred in and out of the three hospitals. His parents were shocked when they first saw him. They also didn't have money for his hospital bills. Friends from Lowry Adventist University helped with money and prayers. The pastor visited often. 3 months passed from the time of the accident until Terence returned to the university. Today, he's a nurse. He's grateful to God, his family, and many friends at the university for his second chance at life. He had put off giving his heart to Jesus, and he realized that after the accident that he didn't want to wait any longer. "I was supposed to be baptized a long time back, but I was kind of scared," he said. "I felt I would have to be careful about whatever I did, so I waited for a long time. After the accident, I sensed I shouldn't wait anymore. You never know what will happen next in life." He was baptized at the university. Terence said another lesson that he learned from the accident was to stop drinking caffeinated tea. "If I had to give a title to my story, I would call it the most costly tea of my life," he said. "It was costly, it cost me a lot of things. But now when I look back, I would say it was worth it. I need a lesson from God. I need to be brought back on the right path." His advice to other people, especially young people, is simple. "God has a plan for every soul here on earth," he said. "He is not done with you until he says so. Even if you feel that you do not have a future, remember that he says in Jeremiah 1 verse 5, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you." I kept repeating the verse to myself when I was recovering. God has plans for you to receive grace and mercy in ways that you never expected or thought of. Part of this quarter starting Sabbath offering will help construct an English church on campus of Lori Adventist University in Bengaluru, India. The university has never had a church building large enough for its student body in its more than 100 years here's history. Thank you for your generous offering. That concludes the mission story.
We'll now give the time to Sister Sabrina for the special music. Thank you, Sabrina, for that beautiful music. At this point, I would like to thank everyone who participated in our Sabbath School program this morning. From the song service, Brother Emmanuel, who helped me with the song service, and the opening prayer by Sister Maureen, and also the scripture reading, which was offered to us by Angelina. Thank you so much. And the lesson review with Elder Nathan Monjin, and again with Sabrina for the music, and also the mission story report by Giancarlo. Yes, we are so grateful that we still have this privilege of worshiping together, congregating, uniting with each other to study God's word. And I encourage everyone to study our quarterly lessons. We will have a lot to learn from the book of Psalms. And I believe that most of you have some favorite verses, memorized many verses in the book of Psalms. And we are so grateful that God will hear our prayer, His promise that He will arise. And let us focus our attention to the sanctuary on high, where God will help us. We have Jesus as our high priest, hearing our prayers. And we are indeed grateful for His sacrifice and for the many things that He has done in our lives. To close our Sabbath school, let's bow our heads for prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for Your promise that You will hear the oppressed. You will arise to defend those who are in need, those who are victims of injustice. Oh God, I pray that we'll have trust and faith in You, that whatever we ask, whatever we need, we'll first lean on You, who will answer our prayers and our requests. Oh Lord, I pray that You will continue to guide us as we travel in this last days of our journey towards the heavenly Canaan. Forgive us now for the sins that we have committed against You. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I will now give the time to the men's ministry leader for the ministry moment.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. All right, so my wife left me. Really? For the weekend. She's up in Camp Kalakwa with a bunch of other ladies that are up there for women's ministry. And, you know, I pray that they have a spirit-filled weekend and come back uplifted and ready to hit the pavement running. The last time they went last year, they came back and those ladies were on fire. And I saw the results of that throughout the entire year, right, Sister Hope? Yeah. So I expect nothing less. So men, we have to step up to the plate. So we have scheduled for this year, the men's ministry, we're going to have our own convention. It was scheduled for March 8th through 10th. However, we have some of our key members who are having a little issue, difficulties with the schedule, with their personal schedules. So I'd like to meet with all the men that are planning to go to our men's ministry retreat. To talk about what we can do to accommodate these gentlemen, or maybe we have to push the date back. Now, the great thing about it this year is that we're going to do our own thing, so we can change the date. You know, we don't have to stick to a schedule that the conference has for us. So just to give you guys a little glimpse of what the men are up to. We're just gonna share, right? Some of the topics that we're gonna put on the table is when life gets tough, how do we handle it? You see, the times are changing. It's getting really difficult. Most of us realize it, and some don't. But we have to prepare for what's coming, and it usually falls on the men to be strong and to show leadership. And so when times get tough, how do we handle it? Another one of our topics that we want to hone in on is embracing God's will for our life. a lot of times we think we know what God wants us to do, and we have an idea, but then we try to do something else that's less stringent. Another topic is let your heart break for a hurting world. As I said before, things are getting a little difficult. It's going to be more hectic as the 2024 progresses towards the end of the year. So we must prepare. So many things are happening, and what I see happening is the devil is really ramping up. And so we have to be fortified each and every day. Your day may be going fine, everything is going smooth, and all of a sudden something just out of the blue just happens. And it could be something as simple as a quarrel with your spouse can turn into something really, really ugly. You know, a family member. Things happen so fast, and it'll knock us off our path. So we need to really get strong. I want to read something from one of our pioneers. It says, a higher motivation becomes realized in the close of time than has previously been in the church. The concern for Christ that he receives his reward and find his rest in the final eradication of sin. That's where we need to be focused on. Egocentric motivation based merely on fear of hell or hope for reward is less effective. That's not where our focus should be. The higher motivation is symbolized in the climax of Scripture, the bride of Christ making herself ready. We need to refocus. And so that's some of the main things that we're going to concentrate on during this men's ministry retreat. And so I encourage all the men who have already made a commitment that we need to look at the dates. For those of you who have not made a commitment yet, I urge you to do so very rapidly because the reservations are being solidified by the end of next week. So I look forward to our men's ministry. I look forward to us coming back, revised, revitalized, refocused, and ready to take on the task that's been given to us. Amen? We'll now have an announcement. My sister, Juna.
Good morning, church, and happy Sabbath. We are happy to see all of you here. I'm sure your week hasn't been easy because it's always full of challenges, but by the grace of God, we are all here so we can worship and enjoy this holiday. So I want to welcome each and every one of you. If you are a first-time guest, we would like to see you. If you are like a returning visitors, we'd still like to welcome you. If you're here for the first time, can you please stand so we can see you? It's always, you know, a wonderful time for us when we are worshiping with guests and friends. So welcome to Pompano Beach, and hopefully you will enjoy the service and get blessed today. So we'll go straight into our announcement. LBM will be next Sabbath, so we want you to bring comfortable shoes and clothing so we can go out in the community right after church. But we're gonna have lunch together, so we ask that you bring a dish to share so we can, you know, eat and then go into the community and have our activity to you know, share the good news with people around us. Also, we want to let you know that the ABC Chuck is going to be here Sunday, February 18 at 12:15. If you have ordered already, you know what to do. If not, you can see me after. There's some flyers outside, so we can give you the information so you can put in your order. And then they're always here on time, so you can, you know, come at 12:15 to get whatever you have ordered. instructions.
Let's turn our hearts and pray patiently. All that Elijah touched him and said to him, "Arise, Lord God of hosts."
Thank you for being our creator and our redeemer. So that one was talking about how your vengeance will be happening one day, Lord. But we just need to hold on. He wants them, Lord, because that's the next generation, Lord. In this time of trouble that we're getting ready to help. You know I'm talking about, Father, I pray for them. Be with all find you. And if it's through us, Lord, let it be. So be.
Really like tithing. It's one of my favorite parts of being a Christian. Multiply it for your purpose, O God, and please keep us as your humble servants.
Even those who we don't typically want to give our love and kindness to, please pay attention to the video.
When Raphael and his family moved to a new neighborhood, he felt lost. He felt lonely at his new school. Then one day, a student came up to him in the hall and said, "Hi, I'm Corinne. I've seen you, but I don't know you yet. Come sit with me and my friends during lunch." Someone else included people who were left out. Jesus. He was friends with everyone. The dinner party at Simon's house was the place to be. Simon was one of the leading Jewish rulers, and Jesus had healed his leprosy. To show his thanks, Simon planned a huge feast for Jesus. She had with her a small alabaster jar of perfumed ointment. When no one was looking, she poured the ointment over Jesus' head and feet. Her tears of love and thanks flowed into the ointment. Quietly, she knelt down and wiped Jesus' feet with her long, flowing hair. Probably no one would have noticed if it weren't for the fragrance. It smelled so good and quickly filled the whole room. People started talking. "That stuff is expensive," they whispered to each other. "It cost what a man earns in a whole year. If she sold it, the money could have been given to the poor. What a waste." Simon had a different thought. If Jesus really were a prophet, he wouldn't let that woman touch him. She's a terrible sinner. Mary was caught, and she was embarrassed. Jesus knew what Simon was thinking. He also knew what Mary was feeling. "Leave her alone," he told the whisperers. "You will always have the poor with you, but you won't always have me. She has done a beautiful thing for me." Then Jesus turned to Simon. "Two men owed money to the same money lender," he said. "One man owed 500 denarii. The other owed 50 denarii. The money lender knew that neither man could pay him back, so he canceled their debts. Which one do you think loved him more?" "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt," said Simon. "You're right," said Jesus. "When I came into your house, you didn't wash my feet. You didn't pour oil on my head. You didn't even give me a kiss of peace. But this woman did all that and more. She has been forgiven for a lot, and she loves me a lot." Jesus showed respect for Mary, the least acceptable person at the party. He even praised her efforts above Simon's, the last person anyone would have expected.
You see, children, it is important to show love and kindness to everyone. At school, at play, at church, some other kids maybe feel left out. It is important to include them, to show love and kindness to them, just as Jesus did to Mary. The others didn't feel like it was appropriate for Jesus to show love and kindness, but Jesus did what he did. And as Christians, it is important that we strive to be like Jesus and do the things as Jesus did. As you've seen here, he showed love and kindness to the person who felt left out. It's important that we do that. In Matthew 5, verse 44, it says, "But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for those who despitefully use you and persecute you." Amen. You may now collect the offering. Thank you so much for collecting the offering. May I please have a volunteer to pray for me? A volunteer? May you come up, please?
Lord, I thank you for giving all of us wisdom and understanding. I thank you that we have food to eat and water to drink. I thank you that we have parents, because some people are orphans. And I thank you that I thank you that we are loving and kind and sharing. I thank you that we have talents. We have talents that we use each day and every day. And I thank you that we support one another. in everything. Like when somebody falls, we can always help them get back up on their knees. Amen.
Thank you. You may all go back to your parents.
Amen for that prayer. Seems like every time I pray, somebody comes and like show me up. And it's a kid. Man. So we need to do some more homework on that. So yeah, that was wonderful. You know. So welcome again. And today we're glad to have the pastor back. Last week we was in Key West at the camp meeting. And y'all missed it. It was beautiful down there. Maybe next year y'all can go. So we're back this week. And the title of his sermon today is going to be Habit, Habit, Habit. But first, we're going to have our song of meditation from Sister Samantha. And then right after that, you'll hear from our pastor, Pastor Verse.
The beauty Amen. Thank you, Samantha and Noah. What a wealth of talent we have here at Pompano Beach, amen? And I want you to know that at camp meeting last week, our family and friends were a great success. And people were asking me, they said, Pastor, can we have them next year? I said, well, we'll see. But we're so thankful to be in the house of the Lord this morning, amen? My name is Pastor Steve Verse, and I want to welcome you to the Pompano Beach Seventh-day Adventist Church. We're glad that you've chosen to be with us this morning. Are you ready to hear the Word of God? Amen. Amen. The title of the message today is Habit, Habit, Habit. And so today we're going to look at the concept of habits. And we're going to look at some habits that tend to grieve the spirit. And we're going to look at how do we change our habits. But before we do, let's take a moment and bow our heads together. Father, we come to you this morning because we need you. We come to you asking for the presence of your Holy Spirit. We do not want to grieve you. We do not want to push you away. So Lord, help us as we talk about this most vital, vital concept of changing our habits. So Lord, we invite your Holy Spirit to be with us. Come, Lord, calm our minds and our hearts. Help us to put away any other thoughts other than your word just now. Lord, take the pressures away. Take the anxieties that we face, and Lord, help us to settle in to the truth of God's word. So bless us to this end, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we have to ask the question, what is a habit? Merriam-Webster puts it this way. She says, a habit is a selected or regular tendency or practice, especially one that is hard to give up. So a habit is something that we do repetitiously, that we do it, and we're going to find out as we go along, it even becomes subconscious. Habits become automatic behaviors that we do that have some components. The word habit derives from the Latin word habere, which means to have or consist of, and habitus, which means a condition or state of being. A habit is a consistent behavior that we do over and over again that many times is difficult to change. Warren Buffett puts it this way. He says, the chains of habit are too light to be felt until they are too heavy to be broken. And so we need to beware of habits. We can have good habits and bad habits, amen? And we want to change the bad habits, and we want to reinforce the good habits. William Makepeace Therapy puts it this way. Successful people aren't born that way. They become successful by establishing the habit of doing things unsuccessful people don't like to do. And so habits can be formed over a time, and there are lazy habits and there are good habits. And so we want to understand habits. Ron Gilbert says this, first we form habits, then they form us. Conquer your bad habits or they'll eventually conquer you. And so we're talking about habits today, and we want to understand from the Word of God that we need to establish good habits and shun bad ones. The Scripture constantly calls us to form good habits. Exodus 20, verse 8, the Bible says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And so therefore, the Sabbath day and its observance is a good habit. You know, it's not interesting that the one commandment that brings with the word, begins with the word remember, is the one commandment that mainstream Christianity has forgotten. And so people want to do things or they do not want to do things. And of course we know the prophetic significance of the Sabbath day and end time events. And God enjoins us to keep the Sabbath holy. And even in the beginning, Jesus established this habit. Luke 4, 14 to 16, the Bible says this, and Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and a report about him went all throughout all the surrounding country. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as was his custom or habit, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. And so God wants us to establish good biblical habits. Now, how do we establish a habit? When the children of Israel were brought out of Egypt, there was instituted what is called the Shema. The Shema is found in Deuteronomy chapter 6. The Shema means the rubbing of two stones together habitually in order to sharpen some object. The repetition of running a knife across a sharpening stone sharpens it. That was the connotation of the Shema. The Bible puts it this way in Deuteronomy 6, verses 5 through 7. It says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. So there's a complete commitment. We're establishing a habit of learning God's will. He continued, and these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them what? Diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. That's not what God was talking about. God was talking about putting these principles in the frontal lobe, keeping it ever before us that we may know his will and do it. And so the Shema. See, the reality is we have a choice, amen? God has given us the power to choose. So what about this concept of habit? Now, there's three things that are part of the habit. First is the cue, what triggers your brain to do something. Okay, like for example, you get up in the morning and my first habit is that I spend time with God. I don't do anything else until I spend time with God. And that habit has been established. And I don't let anything, barring a death or something like that, to stop my habit of spending time with God. And so I have chosen, and that cue that I'm going to spend time with God is when that sun rises. Amen? And so the sun coming up is my cue that I'm spending time with God. Now, sometimes I'm going to bed when the sun is coming up. But nevertheless, when my eyes wake up, my time with God is spent. A good habit. Then there's the routine. The routine is the action that we do. Like, for example, I have right next to my bed, I have my iPad, and I have my cell phone. And I start my devotional course, whatever it may be, whether I'm going through the Bible or whether I'm reading a section of the Spirit of Prophecy, I reach over there and I do that routine. Now, sometimes we can have bad habits. Sometimes when some people, when they get up in the morning, the first thing they do is run for the coffee pot. And there's a routine, and then there's the reward. The reward is that I spend time with my God, and I get filled for the day. But with the coffee, it's the boost that's given to you. Grieve the spirit away. And then we're going to go back to habits, and we're going to look at some techniques by which are scripturally approved, but yet are practical for us to change our habits. Acts 1 verse 8 puts it this way, but you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you, and you will be my what? Witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Amen. Hallelujah. God has promised us the Spirit. But do we not see the Spirit as we've seen him in former days? Acts of the Apostles, page 50, gives us this promise. The lapse of time has wrought no change in Christ's parting promise to send the Holy Spirit as his representative. It is not because of any restriction on the part of who? God. So God has not restricted the promise of the Spirit. And this is what he says, that the riches of his grace do not flow earthward to men. If the fulfillment of the promise is not seen as it might be, it is because the promise is not what? Appreciated as it should be. If all were willing, all would be filled with the Spirit. Wherever the need of the Holy Spirit is a matter of little thought of, there is seen spiritual drought, spiritual darkness, spiritual declension, and death. So when we push the Spirit aside, the Spirit is gracious, amen? The Spirit does not go where he's not wanted. The Spirit gives us the ability to choose whether we want to do his will or not. Whenever minor matters occupy the attention, the divine power which is necessary for the growth and prosperity of the church and which would bring all other blessings in its train is lacking, though offered in infinite plenty. So every one of us can have the Spirit, amen? And so what are some of the things that we do in order to push the Spirit away? What is the cause? We need to ask the question, why do we not hear the Spirit? Why is the Spirit not as active? And all of us know the reason. The reason is sin. And so therefore, we must understand that we can have the Spirit of God if we will allow ourselves to be filled with the Spirit. Amen? See, the Spirit is not exclusive to any group. The Spirit is not exclusive to any race. The Spirit is not exclusive to any socioeconomic level. The Spirit is available to everyone if we will be willing to listen. And so we must. Dr. Martin Luther King, talking of our modern society, put it this way, the means by which we live has outdistanced the ends for which we live. Our scientific power has outrun our spiritual power. We have guided missiles and misguided men. And so therefore, we can have the Spirit of God, but we need to take away the encumbrances. Charles Grenson Finney, the revivalist of the 18th century, put it this way. He says, if the presence of God is in the church will draw the world in. Amen. If the presence of God is not in the church, the world will draw the church out. So what do we see today? We see the church being drawn out. Because we do not need more intellectual power. We need more spiritual power. We do not need more of the things that are seen. We need more of the things. Point one, and if you have your phone there, or you have your tablet there, let's write down these seven hindrances to the Spirit. What keeps us from hearing God? The first thing to watch out is for hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is one of the things that kills the Spirit, that grieves the Spirit away, not being genuine. What is hypocrisy? It comes from the word hypocrisis, which literally means the two faces. Have you ever heard the word he's two-faced? Well, that's what hypocrisis is. You have one face one way, one face another. It is the practice of claiming to have moral standards or beliefs to which one's own behavior does not conform. It is a leaven of hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is a killer to the voice of the Spirit. Charles Finney puts it this way. He says, it may be that you live a hypocritical life. Your prayers are not earnest and sincere. Not only is your religion a mere outward show without any heart, but you are insincere in your intercourse with others. Thus you do many things to grieve the Spirit so that he cannot dwell with you. See, the gracious guest of the Holy Spirit is only there at our beckoning and our sincerity. Ralph Waldo Emerson puts it this way. He says, what you do speaks so loud that I cannot hear what you say. And do we grieve the Spirit by our hypocrisy? Now, I want you to know right off that there's a solution to all of this. Amen? And so all these things that cause the Spirit to be grieved can be changed. Amen? James 4:10. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. Amen. So if we humble ourselves, the Lord will lift us up. Amen. Charles Finney again. Others are so proud that they cannot have the Spirit. They are so fond of dress, high life, equipage, fashion, etc., that it is no wonder they are not filled with the Spirit. And yet such persons will pretend to be at loss to know why it is that they do not enjoy religion. And so this pride of this, pride of that, pride of being, pride. So we need to watch. We need to be humble with what the Lord would have us to do. Now, what are some of the forms of pride? Very quickly, there's spiritual pride, there's intellectual pride, there's pride of material things, there's social pride, there's pride of place, pride of face, and of course, lastly, the pride of sin. See, if we're too proud to confess, we are not forgiven. If we're too proud to humble ourselves, the Spirit will not dwell with us. And so we need to watch the forms of pride. Now, point three, we need to watch out for worldly mindedness. Titus 2, verse 12 says this, instructing us to the intent that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, that we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. And so worldliness is another thing that saps the Spirit. having worldly attitudes where we don't listen to the word of God and we want to do what we want to do and we want to live for the world and we want to live for what the world gives us. Colossians 3 verse 2, talking about worldliness, he says, set your minds on things above and not on earthly things. Now, do we have earthly things that we need to do? Of course, we need to work every day and we need to take care of things. But what is our attitude toward the world? Are we growing out of the world and dwelling with the Spirit, or are we embracing all these things of the world? See, worldly mindedness blocks the Spirit. 2 Corinthians 7:1, the Bible teaches us, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Turning from worldliness and worldly mindedness will engender the presence of the Spirit. See, the Spirit doesn't dwell where there is no desire for Him. Charles Finney again puts it this way. He says, some are so worldly minded, love property so well, and are trying so hard to get rich that they cannot have the Spirit. How can He dwell with them when their thoughts are all on the things of the world and all their powers are absorbed in procuring wealth, and they hold on to it when they get it, and they are pained and pressed by conscience to do something for the conversion of the world? See, worldly mindedness saps the spiritual strength of the Christian. And we're walking on a trail to God. Amen. We're moving away from the world toward the life of the Spirit. And the life of the Spirit is not worldly minded. Point four, hindrances to having the Spirit, of hearing God. We're blocking up our ears as if putting cotton into our ears. Watch out for insincerity. Joshua 24:14, the Bible says, fear the Lord and serve Him in sincerity and in truth. Let us be serious about our religious experience. Let us put the time that's necessary into growing from glory to glory. Let us take the time to do the will of God. Amen. And so, are we sincere about our experience? Do we take the time to do what the Lord would have us do? Charles Finney again, others do not fully confess or forsake their sins, and so they cannot enjoy the Spirit's presence. They will confess their sins in general terms, perhaps, and are ready always to acknowledge that they are sinners, or that they will confess partially some particular sins. Unless you come quite down and confess your sins honestly and enumerate where you have done injury, you have no right to expect the Spirit of prayer. And so insincerity, refusal to follow through with what God would show us what to do, will cause the Spirit to be grieved. Are we insincere? And praise the Lord that there's a solution to all of these bad habits. Amen. Proverbs 12:22 puts it this way. It says, lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who act faithfully are His delight. So praise the Lord. We can go from insincerity to sincerity. We can change that habit of grieving the Spirit, and we can change that habit of insincerity. Andy Stanley puts it this way. Says, there is something insincere about a man or woman who repeatedly tells God how much he or she loves him while refusing to obey him. And so insincerity and hypocrisy and all this host of things will keep us from having the Spirit of God. And we want God's Spirit, don't we? Don't we want to be honest with ourselves? And I want you to know something, folks. You won't hear sermons like this in most churches, because your pastor has made the commitment to God to tell you the truth. Amen? The truth is what makes us free. Lies keep us in bondage. Point five, neglecting our duties. Others are neglecting some known duty, and that is the reason why they have not the Spirit. One does not pray in his family, though he knows he ought to do it, and yet he is trying to get the Spirit. If you have neglected any known duty and thus have lost the spirit of prayer, you must yield. God has a controversy with you. You have refused obedience to God, and you must retract it. Sometimes the Spirit of God is on our hearts, and the Spirit of God is asking us to do some duty. The Lord is convicting us, and we refuse, and we're fighting him. And we're pushing off the Spirit. See, we do not want to grieve the Holy Spirit, because he is the agent that seals us. Are we neglecting some known duty? Proverbs 3:11 and 12, the Bible gives us this counsel. My son, do not despise the Lord's discipline, and do not resent his rebuke, because the Lord disciplines those whom he loves, as a father the son he delights in. So God gives us counsel through the Spirit, and the Spirit wants us to give up things or to do things or to not do things, because he wants to dwell with us. And when we dwell upon sin and we refuse to listen to the Spirit of God, the Spirit slowly moves back. Just like the mason that builds the wall, brick by brick, we put up a barrier to the Spirit. But the wonderful thing is, even if we built up that brick wall, we can take that down by changing those habits, amen? And all of us have done it. I've been under conviction at times, and God's asked me to do things, and it's hard for me because I like it. Can we be honest with God and ourselves? Can we be filled with the Spirit? And can we allow the Spirit of God to operate in our lives, to clean us up? We all need to be clean. Amen. And so the Spirit does not give us any counsel that's not our good to do. Amen. See, because the Spirit loves us. And the Spirit knows us intimately. And when the Spirit convicts us of something, we need to do it. Sometimes even when we don't understand, he will help us. So neglecting our duty. Robert Baden Powell, the great World War II general, put it this way. He says, we never fail when we try to do our duty. We always fail when we neglect to do it. And so are we going to have the presence and power of the Spirit, or are we going to play church? That is the question. Now, these messages are not popular, but we are in the last days, amen? And God is giving his church counsel and telling us how we can be saved. Amen. Amen. I don't want to have anything that the Spirit doesn't want me to have. Amen. God's told me give up some of these things because they're not good for you to have. And then sometimes God says, take on this thing that you don't want to. One time the Lord convicted me, Steve, you need to be more timely. I grew up in the hood, and you got there when you got there. And I'd just slink along and just take my time, and I'd be late to things. And then I got into the ministry, and the Lord said, Steve, you need to be more timely. You need to keep your commitments, and you need to arrive on time. And it grated against my whole nature because, hey man, I was floating easy. I'm not getting paid for this. And the Spirit was on me, Steve, you need to be more timely. And so what I did is I began to take steps. I began to change that habit. And you know, I did some crazy things. I set my clock 15 minutes fast. So that I knew that if I left right at that time, I would be on time. It worked. And then I got me a little book, and I wrote in my book, and I had a schedule. And when people committed to me, I committed to them. I was not late anymore. Now, all of you know how timely I am, don't you? If I'm going to be late, guess what? I call you. See, because that's one of the things that for me, I don't know what your issue is. That's between you and God. But I learned to be on time. I learned to be early. Because the Spirit of God was convicting me, and I could have said, no, I don't want to do that. And that would have destroyed my effectiveness eventually in ministry. And so when God asks us to do things, he gives us a duty, we should do it. Amen. Galatians 6, verse 9 says this, let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. We all have deficiencies of character. I have things that God's convicting me all the time. He's saying, Steve, you need to change this. Steve, you need to do this. Steve, you need to not do that. Let us listen to the Spirit. And not neglect duties that we should do. Because two things. Number one, it destroys our effectiveness. And then secondly, it destroys our peace. Oh, don't ever give up that peace of Christ. Because that's what helps us make it through the world. Now, point six on not hearing the Spirit. Watch out for resisting the Spirit. See, some of us may be resisting the Spirit. The Spirit is asking us to do something or to not do something, and we're rebellious and we don't want to do it. Don't resist the Spirit. Charles Finney again. Perhaps you have resisted the Spirit of God. Perhaps you are in the habit of resisting the Spirit. You resist conviction in preaching when something has been said that has reached your case. Your heart has risen up against it and resisted. Many are willing to hear plain and searching preaching so long as they can apply it all to others. See, is it the man over there? Oh, he needs to hear that. Maybe I need to hear it. So don't resist the Spirit, because the Spirit will lead us into greater godliness. Amen? Amen? So let's not resist the Spirit. And so resisting the Spirit will keep us from having the spirit of prayer. See, do not resist the Spirit. There's an old saying, you can't box with God. And so we need to understand that resisting the Spirit is a futile exercise. And when the Spirit convicts us and comes into us, He gives us a time to process what we should do. And God gives us always the choice. God is so gracious that He will not push Himself on us. He will give us His Spirit. Hebrews 10, 3 through 6 says this, "For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised." So God wants us to endure and to listen to Him and not to resist His calls from the Scripture or from His commands. And God promises us help if we're resisting the Spirit. Matthew 11, 28 to 30. "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Amen. "For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." So when God wants us to do something, He gives us the indicator. And I've been studying music. And by the way, Nate did such a fine job on the music thing. I'm almost done, and we're going to do a whole series on music. I discovered something when I did that research. At the base of your brainstem is what's called reticular activator. And these reticular activators, I believe God has placed there so that we will have moral agency within our minds. And whenever something comes to you, whatever it may be, a suggestion or whatever, there's always at least a 2-second delay in every thought that comes. So if a thought comes into your mind, these reticular activators freeze it for at least 2 seconds so that you can make a decision. Ellen White puts it this way. She says, God's people will never be placed at a place where it's absolutely necessary to sin. So God put these reticular activators at the base of our brainstem so that boom, the thought comes, we have time to process it. Thoughts do not just rush in. God has given us the moral agency to filter what comes in so that we can make a decision. And the Spirit comes to us and He says, do this or don't do that. And then He gives us the time to make a decision. And the more we respond to the Spirit, the greater the Spirit is evidenced in our lives. Amen? And so if we listen to the Spirit, we have more of the Spirit. If we deny the Spirit gets less and less and less and less, just like the brick in the wall. When we put that final brick in place, then the Spirit does not strive with us. Then we've grieved the Spirit of God. Don't ever grieve God's Spirit. Now, if we're struggling with things, God will help us. He'll let us process it, and He will help us to do things, but let's not resist Him. We do not want to resist the Spirit. That's dangerous, dangerous. Point 7, on hearing God, watch out for spiritual laziness. This is probably the one area where all of us can be extremely subject to laziness. just not doing it. Just not practicing the spiritual disciplines we should. Charles Finney again puts it this way, perhaps you do not pray for the Spirit, or you pray and use no other means, or pray and do not act consistently with your prayers, or you use means calculated to resist them. Or you ask, and as soon as he comes and begins to affect your mind, you grieve him right away and will not walk with him. Now, some people fill their lives up with so much activity that there's not time for God. Sometimes we have so many commitments that we just crowd God out. We can't do that. We've got to make God's time a priority, amen? And if we make that a priority, God will take care of all this other stuff. I want you to know something, that I'm very busy. I wear about 5 hats. And the time in my day is very scheduled, and I'm constantly busy, amen? Because the Lord knows that if I'm not constantly busy, that I'll mess up. But I have some priorities, and we all should. Nothing is going to stop my time with God. Nothing. And when God speaks to us, we should listen. The Spirit of God wants us to know him more. Proverbs 21, 25, and 26, the Bible says this, lazy people who refuse to work are only killing themselves. All they do is think about what they would like to have. The righteous, however, can give and give generously. So are we lazy? Are we just there? Hebrews 2:3 says this, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? So God wants us to understand that we need to watch spiritual laziness. James 4:17, remember, it is sin to know what you ought to do and then not to do it. So the Bible gives us the admonition to not be lazy about things. See, Jesus gave us a warning, those who are pushing off the Spirit. See, when we grieve the Spirit, another spirit can come in. Luke 11:24-26 says, when the impure spirit or unclean spirit comes out of a person, it goes through the arid places seeking rest and does not find it. Then it says, I will return to the house I left. And when it arrives, it finds the house swept and clean, put in order. Then it goes and takes 7 other spirits more wicked than itself, and they go in and live there. And the final condition of that person is worse than the first. So we need to be careful to not grieve the Spirit of God. We need to listen to the God of heaven because he wants to save us. Amen. See, God wants to save us from ourselves. I want to tell you something right now, and I'm convinced of this, that we are in the last days and that God is pouring out his Spirit and that the devil is pouring out demons. And people in churches are making decisions that are faithful and eternal. See, God gives us a last day promise and warnings. And I want to take just a couple minutes here and look at this concept. Why are we seeing so much spiritualistic demonic activity? And we're even beginning to see it in Seventh-day Adventist churches. We're seeing things that we have never seen before. We're seeing problems. Before the final visitation of God's judgments upon the earth, there will be among the people of the Lord such a revival of primitive godliness that has not been witnessed since apostolic times. Amen? This is God's people. This is talking about the remnant church. The enemy of souls desires to hinder this work. And before the time for such a movement shall come, he will endeavor to prevent it by introducing a counterfeit. In those churches which he can bring under his deceptive power, he will make it to appear that God's special blessing is poured out. There will be manifest what is thought to be a great religious interest. So, churches that are in apostasy, and she's talking about our people, that there's going to be a supposedly great spiritual manifestations. Now, what are these manifestations? She continues. There is an emotional excitement, a mingling of true with the false that is well adapted to mislead, yet none need be deceived. In the light of God's word, it is not difficult to determine the nature of these movements. Whenever men neglect the testimony of the Bible, turning away from those plain soul-testing truths which require self-denial and renunciation of the world, there we may be sure that God's blessing is not bestowed. So these two movements, God's spirit being poured out, and then there's a satanic spirit that's being poured out in churches that refuse to do God's will. Continuing, the Lord has shown me would take place just before the close of probation. Are we near the close of probation? Yes, we are. Notice with me. Every uncouth thing will be demonstrated. There will be shouting with drums, music, and dancing. The senses of rational beings will become so confused that they cannot be trusted to make right decisions. So there's going to be an ecstatic excitement that's going to sweep over our churches. The satanic pouring out of his spirit that's claiming to be the spirit of God. Continuing. A bedlam of noise shocks the senses that perverts that which, if conducted aright, might be a blessing. The powers of satanic agencies blend with the din and noise to have a carnival. And this is termed what? The moving of the Holy Spirit. You see where I'm going? Those things which have been in the past will be in the future. Satan will make music a snare by the way in which it is conducted. And so on this wave of godliness that comes, the Spirit's being poured out in the life of people, and then those who don't want to do his will be deceived by another spirit. Then finally she counsels, let us give no place to strange exercising, which really take the mind away from what? The deep movings of the Holy Spirit. God's work is ever characterized by calmness and dignity. That's the difference. The devil brings the excitement. The devil brings all of the things in his train. The Spirit of God works upon the people in our minds so that we will repent and we will change. We don't block the Spirit. See, we can block the Spirit by the things that we do. Have you noticed what's happening in many, many of our churches? These are not Pastor Versus words. This is the spirit of prophecy. And so excitement and busyness and bands and nice little skits and all of that. Are we listening to the Spirit of God in the morning? Is he affecting our minds and our hearts? And are we listening to him every day? And are we changing? Or are we drowning out the Spirit by the many activities that we can do from day to day? Now, in closing, I want us to go to Elijah. Turn with me to 2 Kings 19, 1 and 2. I know we're going a little bit long today, but I think this is so important. And we have an example of this false moving of the Holy Spirit and then the true gift of the Spirit. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done and how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. You remember the story. Elijah had the high spot in his life, amen? And he went in and he confronted King Ahab, and then he took care of the prophets of Baal. He had gotten rid of them. And then Jezebel sent a messenger under Elijah, saying, "Let the gods do to me and more also if I make not your life as the life of one of them." Of course, you know what she's talking about, the slaying of the prophets. And Elijah got scared, didn't he? He got scared. See, Elijah knew how the worship was. And if you read the narrative, you see that they did all kinds of things. You remember on Mount Carmel when Elijah said to them, "Whoever's God answers by fire, that's God." And they did all kinds of things. They run all around and they had all the bands going. And the Bible says they even cut themselves. They were talking in tongues and they were doing all of these things because it was a false revival. And then the prophet Elijah stood up and he gave a simple prayer. And then what happened? What was the evidence? The fire of God came down and consumed the sacrifice, consume the altar, consume the water that was all around. See, God was proven true. But see, many times when God's people have a great success, the devil comes in and tries to bring in a deception. And so Elijah ran away. Do we sometimes run away? When the Spirit of God is calling us, do we resist? I hope not. And so he went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under the juniper tree and requested that he may die. "It is enough," he said. "Now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers." And so the Lord God had come to him. Now, do we get discouraged? Yes, we do. Do we get despondent? Yes, we do. But God has promised that he will be with his people. If you're struggling with some sin, God will help you. Amen? And so all of us, we're human by nature, and we have weaknesses, but we take those weaknesses to God and he helps us. Amen? Is God helping you today? Amen. And so God has to go searching for him. Now, there's some principles in here about resting in the Lord and all of that. And the angel of the Lord came to him a second time and touched him and said to him, because the journey is too great for you, arise and get drink. God will only give us as much as we can handle. Amen? And so the Spirit doesn't overwhelm us. The Spirit slowly, carefully, ever so tenderly encourages us to turn to him. Amen. God is so loving and so caring, but yet God will tell us the truth. And that's what we need, folks. We need the truth. Because the truth is what makes us free, not lies. And so he did the drink and all that, showing that God is mindful of our condition. God knows every one of our hearts. Amen? And the Spirit knows just how much pressure to apply. Amen. See, that's why we can't be consciences for other people. See, because we don't know where everybody else is at. And we can share the truth of God's word and then allow the Spirit to apply it. Amen. And so God, the angel of the Lord, came to him. And Elijah says, oh, woe is me, I'm the only one. We're not the only one, folks. There's a multitude of people who are having the same struggles that you have. The Bible promises that with any temptation, God will always provide a way of escape. Amen. So if you're tempted, don't worry about it. Just obey the word of the Lord and he will make it right. Amen. And so God wanted Elijah to remember. Because the drums of Mount Carmel was ringing in his ears. And folks, the drums of Mount Carmel are ringing in our ears. We are in the last days. And the devil is using any kind of trick or sophistry or emotion or all of the other things to deceive the people of God. Because he knows that he causes you to be lost. He doesn't have to suffer for your sin. Amen. And so all of this is swirling around us, and the child of God, we're on our knees and we're asking God to lead us and to help us and to guide us and to give us strength, because it's the hard way. See, everybody else is going the easy way. And so what we need to do, we need to say, Lord, help me with myself. Help me to be changed. Help me to be a new person. Help me to have the Spirit of God. And help me not to resist, because I want to glorify you. Amen. See, we're in a battle. We're in a battle just as real as bullets and guns. We are in a spiritual battle where the devil is trying to take your soul. And there's plenty of people that will tell you and they will assist you. And there are Seventh-day Adventists saying, come on over here, man. We got some bands over here. We got the easy way. I don't want the easy way. I want God's way. Amen. And if we're going to do God's way, let's do it. Amen. See, because one day playing church is going to be done. The Lord is going to crack the skies and he's going to be looking for those who have made the sacrifice, for those who love and care and work and live for him, See, all of it's going away. And God gives him counsel. He says, and he said, go forth and stand on the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind went forth, rent the mountains. And it broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. Then he goes on. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. So Lord, where was he? Was God in all the emotion? Was God in all the movement? Was God in all the things that we see all around us today? So where is God? Listen to me. He says, after the fire, after the earthquake, after the wind, there is a still, small voice. A voice that whispers. A voice that says, my child, do my will. My child, don't do that. My child, do that. My child, stay in the scripture. My child, don't be fooled by the placards. Don't be fooled by the advertising campaigns. Don't be fooled when the body wants to move. Don't be fooled by culture. And don't be fooled by those who are in apostasy and they're gathering people there to be bound and to be burned in the last days. So what's the solution? What's the solution to this dilemma that we're in? All around us, we have this all affecting us every day, droning like a perpetual wheel. The Bible puts it this way. These six things doth the Lord hate? Yea, seven are an abomination unto him. A proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked imaginations, feet that are swift in running to mischief, a false witness that speaketh lies, and he that sows discord. These are the things that God hates, and these are the things, if you look at it, it's all summed up in these seven dreadful habits that keep us. But are we to do it alone? No way. Isaiah 41, 13. For I am the Lord your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. Just like Elijah on the mount, when he ran away, God sent his comfort to be with him. See, the Holy Spirit is called the Comforter of God. The Holy Spirit will help us in our infirmities. The Holy Spirit will help us in our weakness. Psalm 46, 1, the Bible says this, God is our refuge and what? Strength. A very present what? Help in what? In time of trouble. See, the Spirit of God will help us to obey. See, we cannot obey without the Spirit. That's why we need him. Psalms 109, 26, help me, O Lord my God. Can you hear the pathos there? Save me according to what? Your loving kindness. Oh, God wants to save us, and he'll do just about anything outside of his will. See, God will help you. Psalm 146:5, the Bible says this, blessed are those whose help is what? Is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God. One anonymous author puts it this way, faith isn't about asking God to stop the storm. Faith is about trusting God to help you through the storm. God will help us through, amen. Now, how do we do it? What's the solution? What is the solution? Here we go. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's where it is. We've come full circle now. Psalm 33:20. Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help. See, he's our help, and he's not asked us to do it alone. Now let's talk about these habits. With any habit that you have, you want to ask some questions. Okay, what is the purpose of this habit? Is this habit working? Is it godly? And then lastly, should I quit it? Ask the Spirit of God for any habit that you have that you may be struggling with and say, Lord, is this something you would like me to do? Or is this something that you would like me to stop? And when the Spirit of God says stop, then you stop. Give him the reign of your life. Now, there are some ways to help you with your habits. Let me give you just two very quickly. First of all, there are habit trackers. You can get them right on your cell phone. You can put in your habits and they'll track your habit and they'll help you to change bad habits and to reinforce good ones. And then the second concept is habit stacking. It's where you do a good thing and you add another good habit on top of it. This is the latest research. If you stack good habits, it will reinforce the good ones and it will help the new ones that you're seeking to do to be more reinforced. So how do we do it? We change the routine. This is Steps to Christ, page 47. Says, many are inquiring, how am I to make the surrender of myself to God? You desire to give yourself to him, but you are weak in moral power, in slavery to doubt, and controlled by what? The habits of your life of sin. Your promises and resolutions are like ropes of sand. You cannot control your thoughts, your impulses, your affections. The knowledge of your broken promises and forfeited pledges weakens your confidence in your own sincerity and causes you to feel that God cannot accept you. But you need not despair. Amen? So there's a solution coming. What you need to understand is the true force of what? The will. This is the governing power in the nature of man, the power of decision or the power of choice. Everything depends on the right action of the will. The power of choice God has given to men, it is theirs to exercise. Notice with me, you cannot change your heart. You cannot of yourself give to God its affections, but you can do what? Choose to serve him. You can give him your will. He will then work in you to do what? To will and to do what? And to do according to what? His good pleasure. So we don't have to have all of the power to change. We just turn our will over to Christ, and he will give us the power. Amen? See, this divine agency can change us from the inside out. He can give us new habits. He can give us new indications that the Spirit is with us. Thus, your whole what? Nature will be brought what? Under the control of who? The Spirit of Christ. So we will turn our wills over to God and listen for his indication, and he by his Spirit will give us the power to obey. Amen. So it's not biting the bullet. It's not I'm going to have all my willpower. No, it's submitting to the Spirit of God, and he will give us the power. Amen. Your whole nature will be brought under the control of the Spirit of Christ. Your affections will be centered, what? On him. Your thoughts will be in harmony with him. There's the secret. There's the secret. The secret is to turn our lives over to God and ask him for the help that we need, and he will give it to us. So we don't resist, we submit. Excuse me. So the apostles in old times had the Spirit. God promises the Spirit to you and me. Amen. And so today, what do we want to do? Are we going to listen to the Spirit of God? Or are we going to put all these fabrications and all these substitutions and our will and all of that before God? That's the plain choice. And so, I want to ask you today, do you want the Spirit of God? Do we want to have the power that God wants us to have? And if we do, then God has promised that he will give us his Spirit. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we come to you thanking you for the promise of the Spirit. And Lord, some of us today, even myself at times, we've practiced all these bad habits. But Lord, give us a new heart. You have promised us that you will be with us even to the end of the world. So Lord, be with us. And maybe there's that one that needs your Spirit in a special manner. Lord, we all need your Spirit. And Lord, we ask that you will pour out your Spirit on all flesh, and that you will bring us to the kingdom. And so, Lord, please bless us to this end. Help us not to forget these things, but to remember them, because blessed are you if you do them. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us all stand and take our hymnals in hand as we sing our closing song, number 625, Higher Ground, number 625.
Yeah.
Shall we look to the Lord in benediction? Father in heaven, we thank you for bringing us here, Father. We needed this sermon, Lord. We all have bad habits. And we ask, Lord, this week, Father, that through your Holy Spirit, that we can work on them and change the bad to the good. But we can't do it alone. We need the Spirit of God. So if we pray for the Spirit this week, Father, to descend upon your people and get us on the right track so that we all may be saved in your kingdom. Now be with us as we leave this place. Help us to remember that today is the Sabbath day, and it's your day, and to respect and reverence it. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Bye.